are the process, how to solve the questions, and you got to know that how to calculate different angles and different dimensions in case of a Ackermann mechanisms. And while solving the, you can say, questions of Ackermann mechanisms, you may need to use the, you can say, equations of the perfect rolling conditions. So both the things should be, you can say, you should remember both the, you can say, expressions. Moving on to this today's class, suppose, see, right now, so far in this unit, we talked about steering system. What are the, you can say, functions of the steering system that it should perform, what requirements it should have, fine. So for a steering system, see, steering system is responsible for, you can say, controlled driving of your vehicle, controlling of your vehicle, fine, when you're driving the vehicle. So, but in some times, at certain situations, what will happen? Your steering system will not allow your vehicle to follow the normal course. In some times, it may, your vehicle may divert, or your vehicle may, you can say, respond crazily while driving the situations. Right? So there, what are the situations in which your vehicle may drive, you can say, out of expectations? So let's try to discuss those situations. Like in the previous lecture also, we saw animation just to understand what do you mean by these two conditions, understeering conditions and oversteering conditions. So basically, suppose, as we can see that these dotted lines, the white dotted lines, it represents the normal driving condition. Suppose when this vehicle is taking a turn, this should take a turn in this way. When you are, suppose you learn the perfect rolling condition, you have calculated Ackermann mechanisms, and according to your estimation and calculations, your vehicle should, you can say, take a turn in this way, which is denoted by a white dotted line. Okay, but maybe certain due to certain problems, maybe due to certain you can say factors, this vehicle, instead of moving on this line, it is moving like this. Okay, it is taking a turn with a greater turning radius. Okay, or I can say it is a, you can say, less sharp turning is taken by this particular vehicle. Right? So this situation is called as understeering situation. Somebody texted. Thank you, Aditya. Fine. And in the second situation, what we can see over here, in the second situation, if you see that the vehicle has taken a turn in a slightly lesser turning radius than the estimated values. Right? So this situation is called as oversteering condition. So you should be clear that at some point, due to some you can say factors, your vehicle may experience understeering and oversteering conditions. So that we are going to learn that what are those factors, what are these factors which will result in understeering and oversteering conditions. Okay. But before that, let's try to, you can say, understand one angle, or which was again, at the beginning of this lecture, it was this name I heard from Avneet also, slip angle. So before discussing this understeering and oversteering steering situations or conditions, let's try to understand what is slip angle. So basically, suppose in this case, when the vehicle was taking a turn, when this vehicle is taking a turn, fine. So what is happening with the wheel? Suppose the wheels are positioned in this manner. Fine. So on this vehicle, you can say centrifugal force is acting, fine, at the CG of this vehicle. So if I distribute that component of a centrifugal force on the wheel, there will be a, you can say, side thrust which is acting on the wheel also. Fine. Now, due to the side thrust, your wheel may point in any direction. Suppose your wheel is pointing in this direction, but your actual movement is in this direction. Fine. So the angle formed between these two directions, that angle is called a slip angle. Okay. If I take you back to this slide, basically from this image also we can see. See, right now this wheel is trying to take a turn in this direction. But due to centrifugal force, or I can say a side thrust will act on this wheel, fine. See, right now the wheel is pointed in this direction where it wants to take a turn, but its actual movement will be slightly deviated. So that slight deviation in the actual movement of the vehicle and the pointing of the wheel. So that angle between these two lines, that angle is called a slip angle. Okay, that this angle is called a slip angle. And why this is happening? Because of the side thrust. Okay. Whenever the side thrust is acting on the wheel, you can see, suppose this is these are the treads of the wheel. Okay, so when the side thrust is acting on the wheel, you can see the wheel will have slight distortion also. You can see the tread is slightly distorted. You can see deflected tread path, right? Because the side thrust will deflect the treads. And so due to this treading, so this wheel will rotate some extra direction. See, suppose when you are steering, you will rotate, you will turn the wheel at this angle, but due to the side thrust, this motion will be slightly deviated from the pointing direction of the wheel, right? So that deviation is by certain angle. So that angle is called a slip angle. Okay, this angle is called a slip angle. You should understand why the slip angle forms. Okay, basic reason is this reason, fine. Now, if I read the definition, you can see that in a vehicle dynamics, slip angle is the angle between direction in which the wheel is pointing and the direction in which it is actually traveling. So that is the angle between the forward velocity. You can say the angle between the forward velocity, it has been drawn here. Let's say Vx is the forward velocity. So it is the angle between the forward velocity Vx and the sum of the wheel forward velocity and the lateral velocity. See, the wheel is moving in this direction also while taking a turn. So this is the lateral velocity. So result of Vx and Vy will be this vector, right? So the angle between forward velocity and the resultant velocity, this angle is called as slip angle. Okay. Now, due to this formation of the slip angle, there could be, you can say, there could be deformation in the tire also. Tire will, you can say, wear out slightly due to this condition, right? Now, due to this formation of slip angle, this slip angle may affect or may arise or may generate the condition of oversteering and understeering. So we should understand that how this slip angle will affect or how this slip angle will, you can say, contribute to oversteering or understeering conditions. Let's try to understand this part. Now, from these two points, I'll try to explain these two conditions and the effect of slip angle on the condition of oversteering and understeering. So what is written in this point, in the first point, is that when the slip angle of the front wheel is greater than the slip angle of the rear wheels. Okay? So when the vehicle is taking a turn, both the front wheels and the rear wheels may generate certain kind of slip angle because the direction of the wheel will be something else and the axle movement of the vehicle will be something else. So that angle will be called as slip angle. Now, what it is saying that if the slip angle of the front wheels are greater than the slip angle of the rear wheel, if I denote slip angle by, let's say, alpha, what it is saying that alpha of the front wheel, if it is greater than the alpha of the rear wheel, right? So such situation may lead to understeering condition. So that is the effect of the slip angle. If the slip angle at the front is greater than the slip angle of the rear, your vehicle may, you can say, subjected to understeering condition, right? And vice versa to that, if the slip angle of the rear wheels are greater than the slip angle of the front wheel, so it may result in oversteering. So if I need to write slip angle of the rear wheels are greater than the slip angle of the front wheel, so it may result in the oversteering situation. So this is a direct effect of the slip angle. So what I want you, you need to remember this effect of the slip angle. Okay. Yes, any question?
Can we say that slip angle is quite similar to sir camber?
No. See, if I
am not
here,
able to justify the slip angle.
Yeah, but see, slip angle and camber are different. See, camber is forming on the vertical plane. If you see this vehicle from the, if you see the wheel from the front, this is the top view. Okay, this is a top view. You can say it's kind of a toe in, toe out situation. Okay, but not exactly toe in, toe out also. In a static condition, we can call it as a toe in or toe out situation. But in this is happening in the dynamic condition. Just a second. Suppose in the static
basically
condition,
this
I can
is
call
the
it
top
as a
view, sir.
Toe in. Can you repeat, Arsh?
So basically, it is the top view, sir.
Yeah, it is the top view. You can see it from the top view. Right? So if I see in the top from the top view, and if the vehicle is static, then I can call it as a toe in situation, but this is not, we are not talking about in the, we can say, static condition. During the dynamic condition and the vehicle is taking a turn, so when you are taking a turn, so due to the side thrust, your vehicle will actually travel in this direction, which is being shown by this red line, but the wheels are pointing in this direction, right? So the angle between these two lines are called as slip angle. Okay, so this is a dynamic situation phenomena, and due to this dynamic condition only, there is wear and tear in the tires also. Now suppose what will happen instead of a rubber tire, if I don't use a rubber tire, and if I use a, you can say, wooden tire or a bulky metallic tires, let's say there are no such concept, you will see such in this case. But if I'm using a material which is, you can say, for example, if I'm using a material which is not be distorted, like the tires are soft material, rubber is there, so rubber can be distorted, right? But instead of a rubber, if I'm using a very hard material like a metal or something else, right? So in such situation, this slip angle would not arise. Why? Because this is happening due to the side thrust. Due to the side thrust, the tire is tilted in this direction. And tilting is happening due to the deformation. Because the tire can deform, then that is why this tilting is happening. But if I'm using a material which cannot deform, so this tilting will, see, this will not deform, so this tilting cannot happen. In that situation, the wheel will travel in this direction. Right? So in such situation, slip angle will be approximately zero. But since we are using tires which are made up of rubber, so due to the side thrust, there will be tilting in the wheel. And when the tilting force is applied on the wheel, the tilting moment is applied on the wheel, tire is going to deform because of the softer material, right? So when the tire is getting deformed, the actual travel of the vehicle will be in this direction. Okay, but the tire is pointed in this direction, right? So this is your slip angle. And the effect of the slip angle we just discussed, that the if you can see slip angle at the front wheel is greater than the slip angle of the rear wheel. It results in understeering. At the other hand, if the slip angle of the rear wheel is greater than the front wheel, it results in oversteering. That is the direct effect of slip angle in the steering conditions. See, these are the oversteering and understeering conditions. And in the normal situation, when you can steer or when you can take a turn according to the estimated values, so that type of steering is called as neutral steering. So you should remember all the three terms. What do you mean by neutral steering? What do you mean by understeering? And what do you mean by oversteering? So when you are taking the turn according to your calculation, according to your estimation, right? So that type of steering is called as neutral steering. And in such situation, if the you can say the if the turning radius is slightly increased than the estimated value, that is understeering. And if the turning radius is slightly decreased than the estimated value, that is called as oversteering. No.
So,
the
sir, is
it
possible? Sir, is it possible that in the neutral steering we will not get any kind of slip angle?
We will get the slip angle, but in such situation, slip angle of front and rear will be same.
Same.
Okay. Actually, it's a property of the rubber.
Yes, that's a due to the property of the rubber, there is a deformation possible in the rubber. And due
so
to
in which, like,
angle,
if we have a bias or a radial tire, then in which we will be having more.
Instead, in the radial tire, also radial tire is not a different kind of material. The radial tire is just only the, you can say, filling inside the tire will be in a pattern of a radial manner or a cross ply manner. But the outer material will be rubber itself. But yeah, the you can say the stiffness of the rubber will change in such situation, and the extent of deformation can be decreased or increased if you change the material.
Okay.
You got your answer. I think somebody saying that my voice is breaking. Siddharth. Is my voice breaking for all of you?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No,
it's
no.
Everything is perfectly fine, sir.
Okay. Now, the question is, as we discussed in the previous slide, that there could be, you can say, difference in the front, you can say, slip angle of the front and the rear wheel. Now, question is why? Why there is a difference in the slip angle of front and rear wheels? What are the factors which can cause this difference? So, that we need to discuss here. Like right now, Karthik is also you can say asking something like a cross ply or you can say radial ply. So the type of material, nature of, suppose at the front you are using cross ply, at the you can say rear you are using radial ply. So if the tire design is different, if your tire material is different at the front and rear, it may cause difference in the slip angle. Fine. Suppose if the tire pressure at the front is different and if the tire pressure at the rear is, see, normally it is different, but it is different from the you can say calculated value, rated values. Fine. So in such situations also. Slip angle variation can occur. Right? So there are a lot of factors which may, you can say, cause variation in the slip angle or the difference in the slip angles. So in the next topic, we need to discuss what are the factors which can affect oversteering and understeering conditions. Okay, as the oversteering and understeering condition is because of the slip angle, so we can relate them with the slip angle also. So if I need to discuss what are the factors which will affect oversteering and understeering conditions.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
सर क्या ऐसी कोई कंडीशन हो सकती है जिसमें हम ओवर स्टेयरिंग और अंडर स्टेयरिंग को यूज कर सके?
हम करते बेटा जब व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट रेसिंग कार्स सो इन सच सिचुएशन डेलिबरेटली सम वी कैन से सम काइंड ऑफ ओवर स्टेयरिंग इज गिवन टू द व्हीकल्स एंड व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट पैसेंजर व्हीकल्स सो पैसेंजर व्हीकल्स में डेलिबरेटली वी गिव अ लिटिल अंडर स्टेयरिंग बिकॉज सपोज एज अ पर्सन सपोज यू आर ड्राइविंग दिस व्हीकल एंड यू सी समटाइम्स वी डू नॉट कैलकुलेट द एक्चुअल स्पीड और समथिंग. So if you're a driver which is used to, you know, drive on a faster speed, so in such situations you may go to the workshop and you may ask the, you can say, the mechanic to set your vehicle to little understeer so that while taking a turn at a higher speed you will be safe. Okay, so such situations can happen. They can be provided deliberately based on the application of the you can say purpose of the automobile. Jahan pe aap isko apply kar rahe hain uske according you can apply this oversteering and understeering condition.
Okay,
yes,
sir.
Is also answering. If you need a drifting condition also, then also you will deliberately go for an oversteering condition. Now talking about the factors, see, all the factors which can affect the oversteering and understeering condition can be categorized under two names or two factors, passive factors and active factors. Okay, passive and the active factors. Now, what are passive factors and what are active factors? Let's just try to discuss this initially. See, passive means it will be, you can say, there at all the time. Okay, passive means it will be there at all the time. Like when we talk about passive factors, so these are the factors which are there maybe due to the design of the vehicle, okay, maybe due to the arrangement of the vehicle, fine. So these are the factors which will come due to, which is already always there in the vehicle, maybe due to design, maybe due to arrangement of the components, fine. So all such factors will be called as passive factors. And active factor will be like the conditions or the factors which will influence during the driving condition, during the actual driving condition, what factors will influence the steering system or steering conditions, those will be coming under active factors. So we are going to classify all the factors which are influencing the steering conditions under, you can say, under the name of passive and active factors. What are passive factors? That factors which are there at all the time, like designing parameters or the arrangement of the components, or active factors which will influence the steering condition during the driving condition, right? During the dynamic conditions. So these are called as active factors. So what are the some of the passive factors if I need to discuss in case of oversteering and understeering condition? Some can say passive factors includes distribution of the weight, layout of the automobile, tire inflation pressure, and we have suspension and chassis setups. So these are certain factors which are under passive factor, and it may these may affect the oversteering and understeering condition. Why they are passive factors? From the name, you can have an idea that weight distribution. So weight distribution depends, see, while designing or while placing the component, this factor can be, you can say, brought into the vehicle. This is the passive factor. Similarly, layout of the automobile. Basically, when I talk about layout of the automobile, it is basically the engine placement. If the engine is placed at the front, so there could be different type of layout, FR layout, FF layout. You know? So based on the placement of the engine and the driving, you can say power axle, we can have different type of layout of the automobile. Again, this is during the designing of the vehicle. Fine. So this is also a passive factor. Tire inflation, that means how much air, what is the pressure of the tire. So again, it's a passive factor. It's not like during the driving condition, you can change the pressure of the tire until unless it is punctured, right? So that is also a passive factor. Suspension and chassis setup. So this is also during the arrangement and the designing condition. So these all the factors are, you can see, classified under passive factors. At the same time, if I want to discuss what are the active factors, so there could be active factors like the speed while taking a turn. So cornering speed could be an active factor. Now this is a dynamic condition. During taking a turn, you can have a greater speed also, you can have a lower speed also. So this is, you can say, categorized under active factor. Throttle position. Okay, throttle position means if you are, you can say, increasing the throttling valve, or if you are opening the throttling valve by, you can say, depressing the pedal, you can say, accelerating pedal. So in this way, you can change this at any time during your driving condition. So that is called as throttle position, right? So cornering speed and throttle position will be under active factors. Kicking of the clutch can be also be under
throttling position is under this.
Harsh?
Sir, my throttling position is under this.
Throttling position. Yes. Throttling position, basically, suppose you have drive kar rahe, when you are driving the vehicle and you have an accelerator pedal. So if you press the accelerator pedal while taking a turn, so aap kya kar rahe, uske engine ke andar zyada air fuel ko, you are allowing more amount of air fuel inside the engine. So that means you are increasing the power, and with the power, the speed can be increased. Right? Exactly, that is the throttle position. And at the same time, when you are driving and if you remove your feet from the, you can say, accelerator pedal, that means you are closing, if you have studied like intake manifold in the engine may, we have a throttle valve. So that is controlled by the positioning or pressing of the pedal. Jo aapka accelerating pedal hai, usko jitna aap press karoge, the greater will be the opening of that valve. If I just need to draw it from the diagram.
Got it, sir.
All right. So these are the active and the passive factor. See, during the clutch, if you start kicking the clutch, it may, you can say, change the speed, vehicle speed, and that can be considered under throttling position or the cornering speed cure.
Sir, oversteering should not be given intentionally, because if it will be given, then it can happen that it can cause a rollover of a vehicle or somewhat like that conditions.
You are true, it is correct that excessive oversteering should not be given. Okay, but see, oversteering we are giving in an application where I have a particularly defined path, like in case of racing cars. So racing cars, in the racing cars, the racing path is already well defined, right? So what you do, you will give a calculated oversteering in such a situation so that rollover is not happening.
Okay, sir.
you want to swing the car on the corner to do a fast lap. Okay. I'm not getting your questions. Swing means the overturning, rolling of the car?
No, I mean, sometimes we induce oversteer in order to improve our lap time because, you know, sometimes the car is like too, like it doesn't respond very well. So that in that case, you would like to, you know, be aggressive with the steering and like swing it into the corner instead of like, you know, then you are inducing oversteer purposefully.
Correct. See, Keur, what Keur is want to say is that suppose this is the vehicle and this is suppose a racing is going on and you are going to complete a lap. So if you are driving this vehicle in this path, right? So you are taking a longer path. What you want to do is you want to take a, you can say a turn. If you can take a turn in this manner, that means you need to cover a shorter distance, right? But this shorter distance can only be covered if you are taking a oversteering situation, right? If you want to take a turn in a smaller turning radius than the calculated or the estimated value for this vehicle, right? So in such situation, you may go for oversteering. In such situation, you are decreasing your distance, and with the distance, the time can also be decreased. And during the oversteering condition, you can take a corner at a higher velocity also. Right? So the time will be saved in increasing and decreasing the velocities of the vehicle. That is what you are saying, you?
Yes. So but
I mean, it really depends on every case, the car is different, the corner is different. So in sometimes it's useful. That's all I'm saying. In some conditions.
Sometimes it is useful. Correct. Mostly, I think I have seen this in the Formula cars. A little bit oversteering is provided in such vehicles because Formula cars have a tendency to go for a longer length while taking a turn.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, again, Formula One cars are pretty well balanced. So, you know, but still they have a little bit of oversteer, you know.
Yes, correct.
But sir, some drivers are also using understeering in such kind of conditions. For example, sir, we can see motor racing Mark Marquez. He's mostly using understeering because he was always doing drift with the rear wheels and using tail brake, having sudden load on his front wheel so that he can increase the turning, he can decrease the turning radius. Sir. It's about technique, sir, I think.
No, actually, everybody in Formula One, like, you know, they set up the car according to their driving preference, really. So, I mean, the cars are very similar, but again, each driver has its own, you know,
tuning
preference.
Has been done according to the driver's preference.
Yeah, so they tune it according to the driver.
Yes. Nowadays, understeering drivers are also using understeering. So, some of drivers are having more experience regarding the racing.
Yeah, Lewis uses understeer. Lewis Hamilton.
Yes.
And Kimi Raikkonen is like very oversteery. Sebastian Vettel is very oversteery. Max Verstappen also uses a very oversteery setup.
But if you Raikkonen see in general frequency, most of the guys are going for oversteering instead of understeering. That is why this type of things are written in the different articles also. That if you go for an application of oversteering, they will you will see these applications in case of oversteering only. They are not pointing out towards the understeering. Maybe it depends on the driver preference. That if he is comfortable with the understeering condition, he can
This thing is producing in these 2 years, sir, in 2019 and 2020. So this is a different riding style.
Okay.
So which these are one is sir, report is also there is about understeering using racing.
Sir, I'll be honest, like Formula One wouldn't be a good example because, you know, all the cars are very sensitive to these setup changes. So they don't really like mess around too much with the, you know, driving style.
The ratios are very high, I can say.
Yeah.
Correct.
I agree, sir.
But again, if I talk about understeering, understeering can also, they can provide initial understeering while taking a turn, but understeering can be managed by accelerating during the turn. And it also depends upon the positioning of the weight. So if the weight is more concentrated towards front or
also,
the rear.
Also, one more thing, like Formula One cars actually have this special like control of like how much you want the differential to look while you're entering in the corner and exiting the corner. So and that is not available in normal cars. So they can like really manipulate how they like, you know, use oversteer and understeer.
Nowadays, not talking about the you can say racing cars, but in case some luxury cars, they are, you can say, equipped with a traction control system nowadays. In order to just to control the oversteering and understeering condition.
Yeah.
So we can discuss about them, traction control system, what they do. Basically, just when the during the movement, if your vehicle tends to yaw, like yawing, if you see, if you assume a vertical axis, so with this vertical axis, if there is a rolling across this axis, so that condition can be called as yaw. Now this yaw is you can say happening because of you can say difference in the traction forces on the right hand, you can say inner and the outer wheels. So if the you can say if the sensor of your vehicle measures that amount or that difference in the traction, it will automatically apply brakes on the wheels where the traction is left. So in this way, it will manage the yawing moment, and again the oversteering or understeering can be can say controlled in such situations.
Yes, sir.
All right, let's try to move on to these, you can say, factors. One by one, let's try to discuss. Now, first factor we are going to discuss is weight distribution. All right. Just a second. So weight distribution, we need to know what will be the effect of the weight distribution. Now, this point says that if the weight at the front is more than the weight at the rear, it will result in, can you say what will be the, what it will result in, oversteering or understeering? Weight at front is more and rear it is less, so it may result in oversteering or understeering.
It'll be oversteering because, you know, there is less weight to press on the rear wheels.
Yes, so it is oversteering, and the situation is because on because in this situation the rear wheels have a lesser weight and the weight is more concentrated at the front. Now, the basic reason what is happening in this case, if the weight at the front is more, what is happening, the wheels which are, you can say the front wheels are subjected to a greater, you can say, weight. Right? So in such situation, the value of the slip angle will decrease. Value of the slip angle for the front wheels will decrease in this case. Okay, because if the weight is greater, there will be less deflection in the tires. Tires cannot deflect so high on the basis of on the application of the side thrust. The tires will not deflect very high values, fine. So in that case, the you can say slip angle of the front will be less than the slip angle of the rear, fine. And we have seen that if this situation arises, it may result in oversteering, fine. So if the slip angle of the rear is greater than the front, it results in oversteering, and due to this weight, higher weight at the front, slip angle of the front will be less than the slip angle of the rear. Next point, if the weight is at the front, weight at the front is less and weight at the rear is, you can say, than the weight at the rear, that means rear is more heavy, right? In such situation, it will result in understeering, right? And basically, again, the reason will be same, because in this situation, slip angle at the rear will be less and the slip angle at the front will be more. So again, it will result in oversteering. So I hope there is no doubt in this point.
No doubt, sir.
Okay. Next factor, if I talk about the layout of the automobiles. So if I talk about the layout, FR layout is the engine will be placed at the front, but the power is given to the rear axle. So this layout is called as FR layout, front engine, rear powered layout. Now in this case, the vehicle tends to exhibit the oversteering on turns. For this layout, vehicle tends to exhibit oversteering on the turns. So you can say on the turns. Now, what could be the reason that why this you can say vehicle is oversteering in the FR layout of a vehicle?
Because the engine is up front and the power is being delivered at the back, so there is weight like pressing up front, but like because the what do you call that? Always settings slip angle. Yeah, the slip angle would be, you know, greater in the rear wheels. Yes, than
sir. If we see onto the weight distribution also. If the engine is placed at the front on itself, the weight distribution in the front is more as compared to the rear.
Exactly. Same reason, in FR layout, engine is placed at the front, so there will be more weight at the front, and more weight at the front, that means it will lead to oversteering. Okay, and the power is delivered to the rear, fine. So what will happen in this situation? Suppose you are taking a turn and you experience oversteering. And suppose, you can say, in the panic mode, you press the, you can say, accelerator. Fine. In such situation, suppose out of panicking, if you press the acceleration, so you will oversteer more. Fine. In such situation, your against the tendency of the vehicle or the intensity of the oversteering will increase further. Because what will happen when you accelerate? See, the power is given to the rear axle. Now the rear wheels try to roll at a very high, at a higher RPM. Okay. Now when the power steer, you can say the rear wheels are rotating at higher RPM, there will be less traction. Even the traction will further reduced with the rear wheels, and hence there will be more oversteering. So in such situation, if you're oversteering with such vehicles, and if you panic, if you accelerate that vehicle, oversteering will further increase, and it may result in a, you can say, very bad situation. Right? That is the FR
layout. Drifting also. That causes drifting. Yes.
Exactly. So because the reason is heavy weight at the front, this will result in oversteering. Now, second layout is RR layout. So basically RR layout means engine is placed at the rear and the axle is also, you can say rear power axle is there, right? So in such situation, again, it is also leading to oversteering. Engine is placed at the rear and the power is also at the rear. Still, it is having the oversteering situation. Can you point out any reason for this?
Yeah, because here the engine, like the weight is like acting like a pendulum when you're going through the corner. So it like, you know, the centrifugal force will like pull it out. That's like my theory, because Porsches do that a lot, like the rear load
out. The reason is correct here. But the proper term which I can use is the greater momentum at the rear, because see, more weight is there at the rear.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So if the weight is more and if you're driving at a velocity, so that particular portion of the vehicle has a heavier momentum, greater momentum. Right. And if you try to change the direction of suppose some big element is coming in your way, and if you try to stop it or if you want to deflect it, and it will be difficult to change its direction. So to change the momentum of such a heavy portion of a vehicle, that will be difficult, fine? So yeah. What will happen? It will continue its movement. It will continue its movement. The rear portion will continue its movement, and it will further result in oversteering. Instead of a heavy weight at the rear, still it will show oversteering situation, fine? So that is the reason, if I need to point out the reason again. The reason will be due to the greater momentum at the rear. Again, it will be difficult to change the momentum of the rear according to the path. And hence, it will result in the oversteering situation. Right? Now, next point is FF layout. That means engine is placed at front and the front axles are the powered axles. So in such situation also, it is again delivering, or it is also showing oversteering situation. Reason is same. Weight, because engine and the axle is also powered. Front axle is also powered. So the reason is same. The weight will be, you can say, heavy at the front. So due to which the slip angle, slip angle of the front.
Sir, but don't front wheel drive cars, they like understeer like that? Isn't that their defining characteristic?
No.
Like usually front wheel drive cars, like, you know, hatchbacks, like they do understeer a lot.
They do understeer. Okay.
I mean, like front layout, right? Like we're talking about like front engine hatchbacks and, you know, usually economy cars, like they do understeer a lot.
Of course they can
oversteer if you like really push it to the limit, but like usually they understeer.
For this, there could be some other factors. See, when I'm talking about FF layout, so I'm assuming the other factors are constant. They are not varying, right? So I'm keeping factors constant. So in such situation, it may result in oversteering, but maybe suppose their suspension is placed like that, that their roll centers are different. Okay. So if their roll centers are offset, so in such situations, just to neglect this effect, they may be, see, the suspension may be placed in such a way that this oversteering can be neglected. So their placement, other factors can also influence this thing. Right now we are discussing this.
Okay.
Right. So FF layout also exhibits the oversteering situation. The reason is heavy weight. But in such situations, suppose in this case, FF layout, you can control the oversteering situation. How you can control the oversteering situation? What you can do is you can accelerate. Suppose while taking a turn, if you're experiencing an oversteering situation, and if you further accelerate, if you increase the speed of the vehicle, what will happen? The weight will be shifted towards the rear. Suppose when you are accelerating, a little amount of weight will be shifted towards the rear axle, right? And if the little weight is transferred towards the rear axle, you can say the tendency of oversteer can be reduced. Okay. Dinesh, where the understeer will be more? FF layout. No, but oversteering will be more in the FF layout also, if I'm keeping just this factor as a constant. And why it will be more, we just discussed, because the weight at the front will be greater. Okay, if in the FF layout, the weight in the front will be greater, and due to which, you can say the slip angles of the front will be less than the slip angle of the rear. Right? But still, you can manage this oversteering by just accelerating out of the turns in such situations. And the last layout, if we are having a four-wheel drive or all-wheel drive situation, so in such situations, we can control the traction forces on each wheel. Right? Since we can control the traction forces on each wheel, suppose you are mounting, like I was giving the example also, traction control system or something like that. So in this way, you can control the traction on each wheel, and thus, the tendency of oversteering can also be reduced in case of a four-wheel drive. Okay? So this will be the effect of the layouts of automobile. Effect of layout of the automobile on oversteering and understeering situations. I hope you got it. Gaurav, is the voice clear? Fine now, because I think it is you can say a person specific problem. Now, what are the active factors? So, active factors, I think I have missed the. Just a second. There are factors of inflation, tire inflation, and suspension and chassis setup. So, I have not included these points in my slide, but if I need to discuss the effect of tire inflation, so can you suggest what will happen or how this tire inflation can affect the oversteering and understeering conditions? What will be the effect of tire inflation?
It's all about the grip. So, for example, in a simple case, first of all, we have to understand what is the cause of the insulation. So, if we insulate the tire less as compared to normal conditions, then it will provide more grip. So that at the moment of turning, it provides more grip in the front wheel. So, it helps to providing a oversteering condition. If it's over insulation, then the grip will reduce. Which is called understeering, sir. So in this way, we can use the tire insulation in increasing our steering.
Perfectly explained, Ashwinder. What he said that tire pressure will affect the road grip. Fine, if you have a lesser tire pressure, that means there will be more grip of the tire on the road surface. Now, if I assume that if the front wheels are having a lesser tire inflation pressure, so that means that the front wheels are having more grip with the road surface. That means lesser slip angle for the front wheel. And if the rear wheels are having a greater tire inflation, that means less grip. So more slip angle for the rear wheels. Right? So again, more slip angle at rear and less at the front, it will result in oversteering. And vice versa is also true. So this is how this tire inflation will affect the condition of oversteering and understeering situation. Similarly, if
Even
I need to discuss
one
the...
factor is also missing, sir, in passive. It's the braking, sir.
Braking is there.
Braking
we can correlate braking with this cornering speed or the throttle position. If you decrease the speed, like if you apply the brake, so it can affect the oversteering and understeering situations. We can discuss braking here.
Yes.
I think the reason why braking affects is because while you're braking, like in that moment, you're actually shifting your weight distribution.
Correct.
From back to rear, from the rear axle to the front axle. So that affects it.
That is what we are going to correlate here also. If you are changing the cornering speed or throttle position, so weight is going to change. The weight distribution is going to change. And further, it will affect the oversteering and understeering accordingly. So that is why I think the brake is just mixed here with this cornering speed. Now, if I need to discuss suspension, how suspension is going to affect oversteering and understeering situation, that depends upon the nature of the suspension spring which we are using. If we are going for a softer suspension or if we are going for a stiffer suspension. So this may affect the oversteering or understeering situation. Suppose you are having a stiff suspension at the front and softer suspension at the rear. So what stiff suspension do? Again, the factor in the pressure one, that is called as road contact. So contact area, if the stiffer suspension is there, there will be more grip of the tire with the road surface. And for a softer suspension, the road grip will be reduced. And accordingly, it will generate oversteering and understeering situation. So that is how suspension system, and again, the suspension system may also shift the roll centers. There are rolling centers, or you can say it may shift the position of the roll centers based on the suspension system. That may also affect the overall rolling of the vehicle while taking a turn. Fine. So again, roll center is not directly influencing the oversteering and understeering situation. Roll center is affecting the weight balance or the stability of the vehicle while taking a turn. But basically, the suspension spring, the nature of the spring, whether stiff or softer, it may affect directly the oversteering and understeering situations. And last point is chassis setup. So basically, a chassis setup, again, it also depends upon accordingly how you design the chassis setup or how you do the chassis setup. Accordingly, you can shift the center of gravity, CG of the vehicle. And if the CG of the vehicle is more close towards the front wheels, front axles, or if the CG of the center of gravity is more close towards the rear axle, accordingly, it will affect the oversteering and understeering situations. So these are all the active factors which may affect the oversteering and understeering situations. Okay. Braking is an active parameter. It will come in the active parameters. So I think the time is running.